Worship is going to be Lord, I Lift Your Name on High. Please join us and sing in. It's very easy. We've done it before. Shane's going to bring the words up for us, hopefully.
It is good to be with you this morning. Glad that you're here. We're going to be blessing our students and teachers this year as we worship this morning, and I'm glad you're here to be a part of that. Also today, we welcome many friends with us, and we're glad that you all have come to be a part and worship with us this morning as we join together. Remember, afterwards, we're going to go eat, going to the same familiar place, Paradise Acres, as John L. calls it, Pisgah Paradise. Yes, you get credit for coining that. You were the first one that said it, but we're going to go eat. And as we have our announcement time this morning, Miss Janice is going to come and share some things with WMU. Remember, too, this week, Backpack Buddies starts. Mark, what day, time?
We deliver the backpacks Thursdays to Ms. Wallfall at the school. Robin and I are going to assess what we have on hand today. We will go to Sam's tomorrow or Tuesday to pick up the stuff, and they'll get packed up, and they'll be delivered Thursday. And it seems to last year that it was, in all indication, was that they were asking for more. We did 40 a week last year. I believe the number is around 55 this year. We're going to confirm that with Miss Wallfall. But as we know, it's a very needed ministry that we do and very appreciated by the school. The children that receive these backpack buddies, there's a good chance that that's the only meal that they would have on the weekend when they don't go to school because of the family's income. So this church has been very faithful at giving to that ministry, and we hope that we continue. Thank you.
That is a vital ministry needed all around our country. And I'm grateful that you are willing to take that up. I've heard stories of children that literally have to go home and hide their backpack so that all that food will not be eaten immediately upon them getting home, so that they will have food throughout that weekend. So this is a vital ministry, much needed, and I am grateful that you're willing to participate in it and present it. Just want to let you know of those you see on the back of your worship folder, those on our prayer list. We want to add Betty Burke. Betty has been in the hospital, is having some blood clot issues, but she's at home now, and they're working on treatments with her. Also, Nick is at home this morning. He's feeling under the weather, so we want to give a prayer for Nick this morning as we worship, and then throughout the week, and you may want to give him a call. I also have an update on Doris and wanted to share this with you. And it's actually, so Doris went to the doctor the other day, and as I'd shared with you last Sunday, she is going to be in hospice care. So they are caring for her and going to minimize her pain and minister to her. But Jim and her have talked, and they have shared this with me. They welcome your cards and phone calls. They welcome your visits. They welcome food if you wish to bring it, because they relish that time. Last week was simply a time for them to continue to process, knowing the news that they had received, and they also didn't know the fullness of it and what they were going to hear. But I talked with Jim this week, and Doris wrote this out, and they put it up on their refrigerator. That we want phone calls, and we welcome phone calls and cards and visits. So give them a call, if you will. I got to find my phone first. You can write this down, because he sent it to me to share. Doris's number is 910-624-1002. Yes. 910-624-1002. I do not have their mailing address. You got it? Huh? No, I don't have. I do not have. Who's got the mailing? Yes, please. 4118. Argentine Circle. Fayetteville, 28306. Okay. So they are. Oh, okay. Okay. Okay, Robin is going to type that up, and it'll be put out on the bulletin board for you to reach out to them. But Jim, I will tell you, because I have not got to speak to Doris, I'm letting her rest. But Jim sounded better. He sounded better. And so y'all continue to be in prayer for them as they go through this. They did not give them any kind of time frame. So we want to share with them and minister with them during this time. I know that their daughters came to visit, both of them, this week, so the food that you bring will be consumed by more than them, I assure you, because many of their family are coming and they're sharing time together. So anything else we need to be made aware of this morning?
Time.
Mark's going to share with you about the deacon vote today.
Today, as you came in, hopefully you picked up a ballot for voting for deacons. You will vote for three of those that are on the ballot. And when you're done, as the collection plate is passed around, please put your votes in the collection plate. The votes will be tallied this week, and we will announce the winners next Sunday. Only members vote. That is correct. If you are a member, you can vote. Okay, we're going to sing a familiar song now. There is a typo at the end of each verse. As I was typing, I was trying to be creative and just cut and paste, and at the end of each verse, he's got the whole world in his hands is how it's supposed to go. You don't repeat the three lines ahead of it each time. You'll probably figure that out as we sing it. You'll also notice that there's some slight word changes to recognize our students going back to school and our school teachers and staff in two of the verses. So would you please stand and sing along with us, please? He's got the whole world in his hands. Everybody should know that one. He's got the whole world. Seated.
As a part of our invocation this morning, I want to ask teachers and students if you will come and stand in the middle of the aisle as we pray for you. Stand right here. All right, spread out back down that way, if you will. This idea of laying on of hands is timeless. We read about it in Scripture. It is almost as if you are giving a piece of yourself to the person that you touch. There is power in the bond, and there is power in the connection that you make. So as you all stand there stand there, they're going to reach out from the aisles and touch you. So if you'll kind of lean one way or another. And everybody from the outside in, if you can reach out and touch as well. So if congregation, if you will repeat after me as we pray this morning. For you students and teachers, we bless you.
For you students and teachers, we bless you.
May this year you know safety and peace.
May this year you know safety and peace.
May you be blessed with an eagerness to learn and discover.
May you be blessed with an eagerness to learn and discover.
May you be blessed with curiosity.
May you be blessed with curiosity.
And not judgment.
And not judgment.
May you be blessed with compassion.
May you be blessed with compassion.
May you be blessed with the ability to see through the eyes of your friends and your students.
May you be blessed with the ability to see through the eyes of your friends and students.
And be blessed to see the world as they see the world.
And be blessed to see the world as they see the world.
May you also teach everyone around you.
May you also teach everyone around you.
Not only lessons of history, science, math, and English.
Not only lessons of history, science, math, and English.
But lessons of caring and compassion.
But lessons of caring and compassion.
This year may God hold you in his hands.
This year may God hold you in his hands.
And wrap you in his arms.
And wrap you in his arms.
In his eternal care.
In his eternal care.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you all for doing that. And it is. We send you all out. You're going to see a lot of different things this year. You're going to learn new things, and we want to be on that journey with you, and we want to support you in every way imaginable as you have a great year. Will you join me this morning as we have and read together our prayer of confession? God of light, we live in the darkness of despair, worried about our lives, concerned for our health, fearful that we are lost from you. Our burdens are heavy, our willingness to forgive, our fear of one another, our reluctance to share that we have, our divisions and quarrels. We long to turn from the dark and light, shine the light of your love upon us and transform us with your love, that it may be on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. Will you pray with me? Lord, it is in your hands. For you have created it. You have breathed life into it. And it is in your hands. And now we that are in your hands, may we acknowledge the beauty of what we have been created to be, who we have been created to be. And may we understand that we are loved beyond all measure. That in our daily lives, though we see a world that is filled with pain, may we who know you be blessed with ways to inject love and life into it. May we be blessed with opportunities to help cease pain and bring hope, to help stop quarrel and bring healing, to help and mend hurt. Father, these opportunities we are blessed with, may we have the strength to accept them and step into the call that you have given us. And as we do so, may we be reminded that we are not alone, that your presence is always with us, and our strength is found in you and those whom you have blessed to be a part of our family. And now may we find strength as we, a family, pray your eternal prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread.
None of us really knows about tomorrow, but we do know who holds our hand.
So giving you a heads up, I'm going to take the next two Sundays, and I'm going to spend some time with my family. And I will leave you with David Elks. David is excited about coming back and being with you. He's been with you before, but I'm available. You can give me phone calls if you need to. And it's just the Sundays. I'll be here on Wednesdays, so we'll continue our Wednesday night Bible study. But I am excited about the journey ahead for all of us and where it's going to take us, because I think it's going to take us to some pretty good places if we'll just follow and let the Spirit lead us into tomorrow. I invite you to turn in your Bible to the book of Exodus, chapter 1, verse 8. We'll be reading through the second chapter, verse 10. A new king came to power in Egypt who didn't know Joseph. He spoke to his people with alarm. "There are way too many of these Israelites for us to handle. We've got to do something. Let's devise a plan to contain them. At least if there's a war, they should join our enemies or just walk off and leave us." So they organized them into work gangs and put them to hard labor under gang foremen. They built the storage cities, Pithom and Ramses, for Pharaoh. But the harder the Egyptians worked them, the more children the Israelites had. Children everywhere. Egyptians got so that they couldn't stand the Israelites, and they treated them worse than ever, crushing them with slave labor. They made them miserable with hard labor, making bricks and mortar and back-breaking work in the fields. They piled on the work, crushing them under the cruel workload. The king of Egypt had a talk with two Hebrew midwives, one named Shiphrah and the other Puah. He said, "When you deliver the Hebrew women, look at the sex of the baby. If it's a boy, kill him. If it's a girl, let her live." But the midwives had far too much respect for God and didn't do what the king of Egypt ordered. They let the boy babies live. The king of Egypt called in the midwives. "Why didn't you obey my orders? You've let those babies live." The midwives answered Pharaoh, "The Hebrew women aren't like the Egyptian women. They're vigorous. Before the midwife can get there, they've already had the baby." God was pleased with the midwives. The people continued to increase in number, a very strong people, and became, because the midwives honored God, God gave them families of their own. So Pharaoh issued a general order to all his people: "Every boy that is born, drown him in the Nile, but let the girls live." A man from the family of Levi married a Levite woman. The woman became pregnant and had a son. She saw there was something special about him and hid him. She hid him for 3 months, and when she couldn't hide him any longer, she got a little basket boat made of papyrus, waterproofed it with tar and pitch, and placed the child in it. Then she set it afloat in the reeds at the edge of the Nile. The baby's older sister found herself a vantage point a little way off and watched to see what would happen to him. Pharaoh's daughter came down to the Nile to bathe. Her maidens strolled on the bank, and she saw the basket boat floating in the reeds and sent her maid to get it. And she opened it and saw the child, a baby crying. Her heart went out to him. She said, This must be one of the Hebrew babies. Then his sister was before her. Do you want me to go and get a nursing mother from the Hebrews so she can nurse the baby for you? Pharaoh's daughter said, yes, go. The girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter told her, take this baby and nurse him for me. I'll pay you. The woman took the child and nursed him. And after the child was weaned, she presented him to Pharaoh's daughter, who adopted him as her son. She named him Moses, meaning pulled out, saying, I pulled him out of the water. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. It's not easy to see greatness, is it? Not just the potential for greatness, which Moses' mother saw in him at his birth. But it's not always easy to view something that is presently happening, that someone is doing, as greatness. Sometimes they do things just because that's what they're supposed to do. That's who they are. Sometimes people accept a challenge that goes far above and beyond their capabilities. Sometimes greatness is birthed from greatness. But then there are also those things which society and culture says this is great. And it's not always so. Greatness is in the eye of the beholder. Some people hold people back from greatness. They see great things about to happen and they look at them, and for one reason or another, whether it be a bias or a prejudice, they attempt in every way to hold that person back from doing something that is great. There are also times when we discredit things that people do. It's too small to be great, isn't it? It's all here. See, the Egyptians underestimated the greatness of the Israelites. This new Pharaoh was afraid, paranoid. The Israelites would have been perfectly fine. Just leave them alone, let them do their thing, and they would have been perfectly fine. They were honoring Joseph, who had brought them out of their land down into Goshen, a part of Egypt, and he had delivered them from the famine. Complete and utter destruction. You remember that 7 years when nothing was produced, but because Joseph had been wise enough and interpreted the dream, he had told the previous Pharaoh, hey, you need to store up some of the excess here. Joseph, an Israelite whom Pharaoh trusted with the entirety of the kingdom. Just run it. I don't want to be bothered. And he took care of the Israelites. And this Pharaoh had forgot. Whether it was the next Pharaoh, how many years had passed between what we read and were a part of last week in Genesis, I don't know. It's unclear as you study all the writings and the teachings and interpretations of it. Some people say there were 100 years or more between Moses and Joseph, and others will say, well, they overlapped, so it's unclear. But whatever way it is, this is a Pharaoh that did not know Joseph. Maybe out of ignorance, maybe out of foolishness. Maybe when they taught them the lessons of the past, as I'm sure that they tried to teach rulers because of a continuation needed in leadership, he just said, I'm not worried with it. But in any manner, the Egyptians had somehow become dependent upon the people of Israel for whatever they were doing, and he was afraid. The people of Israel were also mighty. They were mighty warriors. Believe it or not, in the Bible are written military movements that have been used by the Israeli army for generations. Talk about a continuation of leadership. If you remember your history, which this is not taught much anymore, but it's what, the 7 Days War, or the 7 Years War, there was a movement that made the success for the Israeli army complete. And it's biblical. The Israelis were mighty warriors as well as incredible workers during that time. But this Pharaoh had underestimated their greatness in one major way that is shown not only throughout this entire story, or this story from Adam and Eve through Abraham, through Joseph and Moses and others, of the greatness of their God who is willing to deliver them at any cost against any enemy that stands in his way. Underestimating that greatness cost Egypt everything, as it has cost every empire throughout history everything. Pharaoh did not honor that greatness. And then we see another greatness in this story. A greatness of two women. Back then, especially, no one would have really ever noticed it. It was women. And they did the thing that they were brought up to do out of respect for their God. They did not follow that order from Pharaoh to kill babies in order to protect his power, his authority. And they came up with a reason that was followed and believed. I think that's the thing that I probably am most surprised at, is that they told Pharaoh this story about the Israeli women being so strong and in a manner putting down the Egyptian women. And he went, okay, sure. And any manner he tried to kill not only male babies of the Israeli people, but his attempt to kill off an entire people's for his own selfish gratification and power, he underestimated people. He looked down upon them. And then Moses. In spite of looking at things that are great all the time, how did she know? What greatness did she expect? Really, they're living in the middle of nowhere, oppressed with slave labor. How would this child ever become what God had created him to be? And in a Hail Mary of sorts, she puts him in a boat and puts it in the reeds. Oh, let's not even talk about the dangers. If you think alligators are bad down at Lake Waccamaw, you've never seen a crocodile go to town. But he was safe. And we look at Moses' journey, and in reality, if we looked at it and watched it in real time, would we really see greatness? I mean, he would have probably been seen as one who left his people. He was a part of the oppressor. Let's be honest. He didn't immediately know that he was an Israelite. He was Pharaoh's grandson. And he became a part of the people that were oppressing the Israelites, forcing them into slave labor, hard work, attempting to not only crush their bodies, but destroy their souls. And who can forget? Moses had a speech impediment. You think that's easy to overcome? It's difficult enough today in modern culture. Can you only imagine what people who listened to him talk thought about his inability to say complete sentences smoothly? There's not one, hardly, that would have thought him to be a candidate for greatness. And think about all the stumbles along the way. All the time that the Israelites tried to kind of rise up above him, not listening to what he says. The times when he was stumbling, bumbling through the wilderness, and especially the time when he didn't listen to what God said. Who would have thought that was greatness? In our community, within the Christian community, true greatness is not seen in the accomplishment of the task. True greatness is seen in the willingness to follow the path that God had laid before you. To not only walk along the path, but to step up on the high dive of life and jump. There's an old song Steve Curtis Chapman used to do. And he'd say, I'm diving in. I'm going deep. In over my head I want to be. Caught in the rush, caught in the flow. It's not easy to do. I know we all are willing to do it. But it's not easy to do. It's really not. But it gets easier if you have somebody that's going to believe in you. Somebody that's going to be there to support you. When we are little, people tell us that we literally can be anything we want to be. It is true. Although we do discover that there are limitations along the way in life, our own personal limitations. Some of us are good in math, some of us are not good in math. But we have our own strengths. Some of us are great using our hands, fixing things, repairing things, making things. Others are incredible at cooking. Some of us sing like birds, and some of us just sing. Some of us can stand in front of people and communicate with ease. Others are petrified. But God will call us, and He will call us each according to our own abilities. And it's up to us, the beholder, to listen. For those people who are called to greatness, and let me tell you, all of you are called to greatness. And everybody's greatness is going to look different. I tell you, I said and I think, and I think about the teachers that stood with these students today. A lot of opportunities for greatness. There may just be one student. Sunday school teachers may have one student that learns beyond belief. A parent may have a child that brings about greatness. Sometimes our greatness is not even realized. We may stand in a church service and sing. And it may bless the heart of someone that we do not even see. Maybe someone stumbles across our Facebook page and hears a word that is said or prayed or an announcement. And it inspires them to do something beyond belief. We have no idea. But the thing is when someone announces that I have been called to greatness, it is up to us, the beholder, to support them in any way that we can to help them achieve what they have been called to do by God. Have you seen greatness? Have you seen the potential for greatness? Support it. Guide it. Nurture it. Love on it. Hold it. When someone hears the call, love them. Through that call, through the successes and failures, greatness is in the eye, not only the one that feels called to do it, but greatness is the eye of the beholder. And be willing in that moment to point out when that greatness is achieved. You know, it's not always a multi-million dollar corporation or a championship or graduating number one in your class. Sometimes the student who graduates high school with the 2.0 GPA has achieved greatness. Sometimes the child who has grown up and they've been able to get a job and have a great place to live because of the beholder, a teacher who taught them and inspired them when no one else would. Maybe it was the kid who was really shaky as they drove around, and an encouraging word of a parent, maybe, made them a better driver. Greatness is in the eye of the beholder. And sometimes we have to say, this is great. Amen. Amen. Will you pray with me? Father, we are grateful for our call to greatness. But we are even more grateful for those who support us along the way, who support us in that journey as we fail sometimes, support us as we see greatness not only as something that all of culture and society celebrates in, but Father, in sometimes the small things that nobody sees, the things that matter in someone's life, Father, those things, that greatness is what we are even more grateful for. For Father, you work in the small things. So open our eyes to see the things that are really great and help us to remove ourselves from the things which are grand. For it's in Christ's name we pray this morning. Amen. I invite you to stand as we sing our closing chorus. Come as you are. This altar is open for you. Let us stand and sing.
Would help if I turned this on, wouldn't it?
Come out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your
lay down your hurt, lay
sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home. Go not too far. Lay down your hurt, lay down your heart. Come as you are.
Blessings to you this week as school begins, and not only for the students and teachers, but for the parents and grandparents who are waking up early, having their lives disrupted, picking up grandchildren in the afternoon. Blessings to all of you, and be weary and be aware of buses and people traveling to schools and driving through school zones. Is there anything else this morning? So if anybody's missing a handicap placard, there was one in the parking lot found this morning. So we've got it back here. So we'll keep the doors open when you return to your cars this morning, and hopefully get that back to you. Or if you hear anybody, just tell them it'll be in the church office. Anything else? Will you join me as we pray our benediction? Father of grace and mercy, may we see greatness this week. And where we see greatness, may we give our love and support. And may in those that are broken, we encourage them to the greatness that can become of them as they pour themselves into you and you into them. In Christ's name we pray these things. Amen.